Today, we are very happy to have Isa Hafalier from UDS. And as many of you know, that Isa has been a professor at UDS, and he's an expert in market design, especially auction theory, matching theory, and contests. And as you may know this as well, he has a lot of nice papers and influential papers on top journals, including the AER, TE, and JET. He's gonna talk about his new paper on parallel contests today. And Isa, you have 1 hour and maximum 1 hour and 15 minutes.
All right. Thank you, Kentaro. Thank you very much. So let me start sharing first. All right. Wrong. Just a sec. Wrong slide. Document. Okay. This is the presentation. All right. So full screen. Can everyone see? All right. Thank you very much. Thank you for having me at the Australasian Microeconomic Theory Seminars. And the title of my paper is Parallel Innovation Contests, and this is joint work with Ersin Körpeoğlu from University of College London and Güzan Körpeoğlu from Bilkent University. And some of you have seen me presenting this paper, but we actually just finished a revision and submitted last Thursday. So this version has new results. So hopefully you'll also see something new compared to your last time you saw me presenting this paper. All right. So motivation and questions. So in many companies with the internet started using crowdsourcing for their needs. And an effective way for crowdsourcing is running innovation contests. So among top brands, I think in the last 10 years, 85% of the brands are using some kind of crowdsourcing. And innovation tournaments are a very cost-effective way of doing this. So how does innovation contests work in practice? So organizers post contests, and there are solvers who develop and submit these innovation solutions. And organizers typically reward the best solutions. Many organizations in practice run multiple contests. Elanco is a animal care company that typically runs big contests maybe 5-6 a year. Bill and Melinda Gates Foundation in 2016-17 they ran 14 contests, I think. Challenge.gov is a U.S. Organization that edits solutions to the government entities, and they typically run 100 contests a year. And there are also these contests or crowdsourcing platforms. And I'm going to focus mostly on the two of them, TopCoder and Innocentive. But these crowdsourcing platforms are in practice very important. Like you can actually see that they generate over $1 billion a year, and they have a growth rate of 37%. So it's a very big market. And I'm going to give a little bit more details in the next slide about TopCoder and Innocentive, but these kind of platforms, they are matching platforms basically. They invite companies who need the solutions, and they also have registered solvers who can work on these solutions. And many companies use these platforms. Like big companies like HP, Ford, NASA, Procter and Gamble, they use these platforms as well. And when these either organizations by themselves or the platforms, when they're running the contests, they typically determine or instruct awards and the terms of conditions in all of their contests. So they are running multiple contests at the same time. And they are also determining in the sense that how much award to give or whether the participants can participate in multiple contests at the same time or some other rules. They determine, instruct these rules. And most importantly, these contests run in parallel. So there are multiple contests that the solvers can engage in at the same time. So these solvers work on these contests and sometimes work on multiple contests, okay? And more specifically about Innocentive and Topcoder, Innocentive, it's, you know, it solicits innovative solutions and the categories are wide range. So it ranges from biology to business. And typically the award size are, you know, quite diverse as well. So it can range from, you know, an award of $5,000 to all the way to $1 million award. And we actually had an opportunity to have, you know, some communication with some people from Innocentive. And then they say that solvers freely work on multiple contests and they look at the data and they, for some period, they actually observe that 57% of the solvers work on more than one contest. Topcoder is another company, it's a big company, but it's specific for software solutions. And typically the award size is around $10,000. So it's not, you know, ranging a big span. And in the interviews, we figured out that for lower novelty development challenges like fixing bugs, they discourage the agents from working on multiple contests at the same time. And for more novel solutions, they actually observe that some solvers work on multiple contests at the same time. All right, so the main research questions that we ask in this project are two, okay, the two questions. The first question is, given this, that the platforms or the organizations can set the rules, should they encourage or discourage the solvers from freely participating among contests? This is the first question. And second question, how many contests should they run? Okay. And, you know, these are not obvious questions. And we, you know, in a very general model, we give, I believe, interesting results to answers to these questions. So before starting the model, let me tell you briefly about the related literature, most relevant related literature. Of course, contest is a very big area. You know, thousands of papers are written on it in economics literature and other literatures. And there are different ways that the contests or all pay options are modeled. One is there is a single organizer, a single, you know, a basically contest or single all pay option, where there are heterogeneous in the agents in the sense that these agents are differentiated and typically they have some private information about their like abilities, they call ability, and there is no output uncertainty. And the seminal papers on this are, you know, Moldovan, Asela, and co-authors have written a number of papers, and there is a big literature now among this. And the literature about the heterogeneous agents with incomplete information and no output uncertainty, along with multiple organizers, is not that big. There are a few papers, Azmat and Moller, Dipal Antonio Vojnovic, Bukboyoji, and my earlier paper published last year are a few examples. So in these papers, typically, you know, there are a number of contests, but the solvers, the agents, actually need to choose which contest to take. So none of these papers look at the case where the solvers can participate in more than one contest. So this is mostly about, you know, there is a set of contests available and how do the solvers, you know, choose among which contest to take, but they can only take one contest. The third bullet point, this is starting from Lazier and Rosen in JP paper in 1981. Of course, it's a very influential paper, but more recently, actually, most of the work on this is actually in the operations management area because they actually are very interested in innovation contests. And one recent important paper is by Tarish and Shu. In this literature, there is a single organizer, but the agents are homogeneous in the sense that they are all identical. and they don't have any private information. They are not differentiated by the ability. They are all identical. But there is some output uncertainty. So they choose an effort, and there is this additional noise term that determines who gets a better output. And my co-author Ersin had written a few papers on this, but no one actually has worked on multiple organizers and with output uncertainty. So this is our paper is the first paper that looks at the homogeneous agent case, similar to Lazaran, Rosen, and Tarvish and Shu, but we add multiple organizers, multiple contexts. Okay. Any questions before I get to the model? All right, let me continue. So sequence of events. So in our model, each organizer announces an award for dinner winner for his own contest. So organizers are he, solvers, agents are she. And when they organize these awards, they of course would need to take into account the awards of the other contests. Because in our model, actually the solver's cost function will be linked. So actually my effort here, effort cost here in one, while participating in contest one affects my cost in contest two. Okay, so they also need to take into account the award of the other contests. And given these awards, each solver decides which contest to participate in, and for each of the contests they participate in, how much effort to put at each contest. Okay. Of course, we can make this, you know, the first part irrelevant by saying that you can basically put zero effort. So you know, we will be looking at the case where we decide on how much effort to put each in each contest, and we are going to focus on symmetric equilibrium. But this is like the general sense that what they need to decide, and after each solver decides how much effort to put, they create a stochastic output. Okay, so they will put an effort, and this effort will give a deterministic output, and there is going to be a noise term that determines the ultimate output. And because of this noise term, this output is going to be stochastic. Okay, and in the last step, basically, organizers collect the outputs and award the best outputs. Okay, so this is winner takes all kind of a contest. Okay. More specifically, in our model, we have capital M organizers, and a generic organizer will be denoted by small m. And the winner award in contest M is going to be denoted by capital A sub M. There are going to be N solvers. A typical solver will be denoted by I. And each solver will decide the effort EIM, so agent I in contest M chooses an effort of EIM, and we are going to focus on symmetric equilibrium. So therefore, in equilibrium, the equilibrium effort in contest M is going to be EM star. Okay. How about the output? Output is denoted is given by two terms. The first term is the deterministic term. So when I put a higher effort, the deterministic part of my output is going to be higher. But we are going to assume that, of course, this R has to be increasing, but we also assume that it's also concave. Okay, so it's a concave function. And the error term here is a term with zero mean, and we also assume, for technical reasons, log concave density. And the distribution function is denoted by capital H, and the density function is denoted by small h. So in the earlier, yes.
Can I ask you a clarifying sure. question? So when you say symmetry, so you're focusing on the symmetric case where every participant, every solver is the same, and every contest is also the same.
No. We are going contest. To have extension. Okay, so I will talk about this, but basically the contests are, first of all, in the earlier version that I presented a few months ago, I didn't have this term, small m. So like basically the error terms for each contest were the same. Now we can allow for different contests have different error terms.
I see.
So now they are differentiated. But even when we talk about a symmetric contest, basically when they award different awards. They say that we have everything symmetric, but in the case that some contests are giving different awards than others, and of course then among the contests they will choose different efforts, but within the same contest we assume symmetric equilibrium.
Okay, thanks.
So this is kind of the new new part in the revision, that we now allow for the distribution functions for the noise terms across different contests differ. Okay. All right, let me continue. So how about the objectives of the organizers? First, so we can consider decentralized organizers in the sense that like basically each organizer M is a separate entity and they take into account the other organizer's choice and they try to maximize their own payoff function. This is something we do in the online appendix. Our results for this case is not as strong. So in our main body of the paper and in our in my presentation today, I actually will consider the case of centralized organizers, where there is a planner who basically like top coder or incentive who instruct the awards for the multiple contests. And we consider the case where for the main body of the paper, where their maximization is not actually is the average of the average of the utilities from each contest. And we can think about this as like the long-term goal in the sense that they want to maintain a good incoming companies who are looking for solutions. We also have an extension in which we consider that this is not the average, but the sum, but this paper, the main body of the paper, and today my presentation is going to focus on the maximizing the average payoff. Okay, so this is the organizer's objective function. How about the solvers? The solvers utilities are for the contest that, you know, for each of the contests, remember AM is the award from the contest. I need to calculate what is the probability that this agent wins. So the probability is that my output is the highest among all solvers. So this is that probability. I'm going to tell you exactly what this probability is in a few slides. And there's going to be a cost term. And this cost term is actually quite general in the sense that I have an overall cost function that is of this form. Okay, so Psi of effort EI1 in contest 1, blah, blah, EIM in contest M is going to be given by eta of sum of phi of EIMs. Okay, so why do we choose this? This actually has a, you know, first of all, we can do analytical results with this formulation. And this cost function is very, I think, natural and desirable in the sense that when we consider within each contest, my cost function is convex. Okay, so like if I take the second order partial for the same contest, it is positive. But when I look at across contests, it is negative in the sense that the efforts that I put for contest L actually helps me to get a lower cost for contest M. And this makes sense because they say that I'm participating in multiple contests and an effort that I put like some kind of patent search or literature search on contest L can also help me in contest M. Okay, so, and we assume, we have some parametric assumptions. We assume that eta is homogeneous of degree B and phi is homogeneous of degree P. Okay. And I forgot to say, I think this this R is also increasing concave, but we also assume that it is homogeneous of degree minus K. So this K will appear in our results a lot. Okay, so the three terms basically to keep in mind are K and P and B, and K is gonna be the most important one. I think I hope I convinced you that this is a nice cost function to consider, and it is very realistic. On top of that, we also consider the solvers also have a budget. Okay, so they don't have infinite time. They cannot work on all the contests. They They have limited time, limited budget. In the previous version that I presented, I actually had the budget not in the monetary form, but in kind of like a time form, in the sense that the earlier version had the sum of efforts has to be smaller than some upper limit. Now, by changing this to a monetary budget, actually the everything became much simpler. So, and I think they have the same idea. So this version actually, this is how actually we were able to get cleaner results, and we were able to you know, have the revision also allowing for asymmetric contests. Okay, so we have we assume that the solvers have some monetary budget, so it'll be more specifically you know, given in the next slide. But before that, so the basically our workhorse here is something called scale transformation. For those of you who are not familiar with this, so we take any distribution function and the density function, and when we divide this distribution and the density function according to this formula here, this is called an alpha scale transformation. What does it mean? When you do this, actually, the mean doesn't change, but the variance becomes alpha square. So it just becomes more spread out, okay? So the output shock becomes just alpha times the output shock. And this is gonna be very convenient for all of our results. Okay. So I need to, of course, use subgame perfect equilibrium to solve this. So given the set of rewards, I need to first understand what is the equilibrium among agents. So this is what we do next. And as I told you already, we focus on symmetric and pure strategy equilibrium. So in contest EM, okay, in contest M, everybody else, every other solver except me, are choosing EM star effort. And I'm free to choose any effort EIM. So if I choose an effort EIM, I need to calculate first what is the probability that I am the winner. What's the probability that my output is the highest output among my opponents? And the expression for that is actually not that difficult to see. So for each of my opponents, so I have n minus one opponents, it has to be the case that R of EM star, the deterministic part of the equilibrium, the difference between R of EM star and the choice that I have, R of EIM, should be compensated by the noise term. Okay, so if this noise term is smaller than this, then I win. Then I actually, I'm better than one of my opponents. And if this is the case for all of my opponents, then I win eventually. So this is the probability of winning. It's not difficult to see. And now given this, my objective function is to how much effort to put in each of these contests. Okay, so it's not like I'm not determining how much effort to put in contest one in isolation, because this term, Psi term is actually a term that has all the efforts taken into account. So this is a multi-dimensional optimization problem, okay? And I also have this monetary budget. So I need to make sure that the total cost by participating in these M contests should be smaller than some B upper bar, okay? All right. So now basically what you do here is that you take the first order condition. Okay, you need to take the derivative of this with respect to EIM for each M, and that gives you some kind of some math. And in this math, of course, this P becomes something, and this P actually gives you some this I equation here. Okay, there is a chat. I think somebody asked a question. Shouldn't the budget constraint include expected gain from winning an award or multiple awards? Okay, we don't consider this. So we kind of consider that like you have a monetary budget, and then you cannot use more than that budget. And then after you are done with this, you get the award. So we do not take the award into the budget constraints. I think maybe for some cases it may be reasonable, but I don't know, like for at least for technical reasons, it I think will be quite difficult. Simona, does this answer your question?
If you assume, sorry, I was muted sure. still. Yeah. I was just considering that if, you know, that limits the ability to devote resources to hire people, spending time, billing the hours, whatever that is, the
yeah.
effort.
Yeah.
One could account for the possibility yeah. of, you know, an expectation of what this leads to.
I think that may be reasonable under some situations, maybe not as reasonable in some others, but we yeah. assume that like basically the technical difficulty of that is that it's going to add you some kind of like a probability event, right? So because
sure.
the higher sure. yeah, effort you put, then the, yeah. the higher reward you will get, and that could...
So it becomes endogenous.
Yeah.
It
yes.
becomes
yeah.
endogenous in a way.
But so, that's a good yeah. point. That's a good point. But if you think about this as like I work for, you know, a month and then I yeah. submit and a month later I get my award, then this will be reasonable.
Yeah, I understand. If you're kind of cash constrained, yeah. then you cannot borrow yes. money in the anticipation.
Yeah.
Of
yes, whatever. Yes. So we okay. yes, yes. It's a okay. card constraint. It's a cash constraint.
Yeah, thanks.
Okay, and then basically, you don't need to, like, you can read the appendix if you are interested, but basically, this function is kind of, this function G and this function I comes from the taking the first order derivatives. And now we also, given these functions, G and I, we also here have two functions, E upper bar and E hat. If you look at E upper bar, you see that this B upper bar appears. So E upper bar is the effort where the agent's budget constraint binds. Okay? And E hat is the term in which the budget constraint does not bind. So E hat just is given by the unconstrained maximization where you ignore the budget constraint, and the first order condition gives you this expression. It's a long and ugly expression, but it is in closed form. And E upper bar is the expression that you get when budget constraint binds, when you solve a constraint maximization problem, basically where the also the constraint binds. All right. So our first proposition is that, and the earlier, like the version of the paper, actually were not able to characterize this E upper bar in closed form because the basically our budget constraint was different, but with this monetary budget, we were able to explicitly write this down, and that kind of makes our you know, life a lot easier. So our first result is that the equilibrium is such that I look at these two terms, E upper bar and E hat. If it turns out that E hat is smaller than E upper bar, then the equilibrium effort, I'm sorry, is if E hat is smaller than this E upper bar, then the equilibrium effort is gonna be E hat. So this is going to be the case in which the budget constraint is not binding. And when E hat is greater than E upper bar, then the equilibrium effort is going to be E hat. Okay. And like here, this allows for contest heterogeneity because we like now the distribution functions of the noise functions are indexed by the contest. So in the earlier version of the paper, we didn't have this sub M part. Now we have it. Okay. So once we figure out the equilibrium among solvers, let's talk about the coordinators problem. And let me give you more specific information about the contest asymmetry. So as I told you in the main body of the paper, we consider the case in which the coordinator is trying to maximize the average profit. And the average profit has three terms. One of them is the deterministic output term, and the other one is the noise term. But for the noise term, all we care about is the highest order statistic among the noise. And the third part is the cost, which is the award given to the solvers. And for contest asymmetry, we basically decided to make different contest types. So there are capital J contest types. And we consider that we assume that basically we have a symmetry assumption basically here. For each contest of the same type, the award needs to be the same. And of course, for each contest of the same type, the output shock distribution will be naturally be the same. And therefore, the term that is quite important, all our results, this I terms is going to be the same. And therefore, equilibrium effort is going to be the same. But basically, let's say that we have three types of contests, like a very tough contest and a medium tough contest and a easy contest. So basically, we are going to have these three types of contests. We can allow for arbitrary numbers. So there are like three easy types, four tough types and three medium types. And of course, the total number of contests for summed up over different contest types has to be exactly equal to the total number of contests, which is n. All right. Any questions? All right, let me continue. So we are going to first give you the result. I'm going to first give you the results for the symmetric case, and I'm going to talk about the further results for the asymmetric case. So these results will be similar to what I presented earlier, three, four months ago in Adelaide, for instance. So we need to first characterize. So remember, again, we are now looking at the symmetric case. So capital J is equal to 1. There is only one type of contest. And I want to characterize the optimal set of awards. Okay, so I need to decide. Basically, the organizer is trying to maximize the average profit, and he's free to choose the awards in each of these contests. He can potentially actually choose different awards for different contests. But as we will see in this lemma, actually, he will choose the same award for each of the contests. And how much award to put, what is the optimal award in each of these contests will also depend on whether the budget constraint binds or not. Okay, so we now have again another definition here. Okay, and here, okay, so A upper bar again has B upper bar term. So this is the award that will be the case when the budget constraint of the agents bind. Okay. So when we put this A hat into this function, capital psi, I think, capital psi, then if it is positive, this would mean that the budget constraints will bind, and it's going to be optimal for the designer to put all the awards equal to A upper bar. If this is negative, then there is going to be a unique A hat such that this will be zero, and it's going to be optimal for the organizer to set the awards equal to this A hat, and the awards, the effort levels of the solvers is going to be given by this function. Okay. This is our first result. So this is interesting, I believe, because this is not an assumption. So we do not assume that since everything is symmetric, we focus on the rewards being symmetric. We actually show that choosing the same reward is optimal. Okay, so this is not an assumption, this is a result. We show that symmetry of award is optimal. And we are able to characterize the exact closed forms, basically, except for this part, basically. This is not really closed form, but this is implicit. What is the optimal award? This is the first part of the lemma. The second part is about, how does this optimal awards change with the number of contests. The award, when the budget constraint binds, is naturally decreasing with more contests. So if the budget constraint binds and if you have more and more contests, the agents have to split their efforts to more and more contests. Therefore, you don't need to basically incentivize them a lot. Okay, so you will actually offer them lower awards. This is natural. But for the case where the budget constraint doesn't bind, actually the award can be either increasing or constant on decreasing in the number of contests, depending on how concave the R function is. Okay, so remember the R prime was homogeneous of degree minus one. So K is equal to one means it's exponential. So K smaller than one means that it is less concave than exponential, and K greater than one means it is more concave than exponential. So, and it turns out that depending on, you know, the K parameter, it can be either increasing, decreasing, or constant. Okay, so this is our first result about the equilibrium award levels for the organizer. Okay, so let me, I have 20 minutes. So let me go to the our main questions. So the question one was, when solvers should be discouraged from entering multiple contests? For the non-exclusive case, we already analyzed, right? So we already have seen the case in which agents can freely participate in all contests, and we characterize the equilibrium of among solvers, we characterize the optimal awards, everything is done. How about the exclusive case? For the exclusive case, we are going to look at an extreme. So of course, like in real world, maybe the solvers can participate in two or three contests, but we consider the extreme case in which each solver can only participate in one contest only. And capital pi upper bar x is the average profit of organizers under exclusive case, okay, when the planner determines the optimal allocation of solvers and awards at all contests. So this is going to be kind of like an upper limit. Okay, so if the planner doesn't determine which solvers will be going to which contest, this is going to be the average profit is going to be lower. So this is going to be kind of like an upper bound on the exclusive case. And we are interested in basically telling something when the non-exclusive case is better than the exclusive case. So if we consider an upper bound for the exclusive case, this is going to be okay. Okay. And the first main result is that there is going to be some threshold alpha not alpha zero, such that when we consider a scale transformation of this noise function, the non-exclusive case in which they are free to participate wherever they want to participate is going to be better than the non-exclusive case. And let me give you the intuition for that. The intuition is actually not that difficult. The math is a little bit difficult, but the intuition is not that difficult. So this is an example, and for this example, the optimal awards are the same. So I'm going to look at the two parts. One of those is the deterministic part, and the other one is the noise part, okay? So if you think about splitting, so if you think about everybody is participating in every contest, then I have, in each contest, I have a lot of competitors, okay? So I actually do not want to put a lot of effort, all right? Because I have a lot of competitors. So my effort that I put in the exclusive case is gonna be smaller than non-exclusive case, all right? So this red line, exclusive case, is gonna be above the green line, but actually it turns out that the difference between the red and green line is constant. How about the second term, the stochastic term? Okay, the output is also determined by the stochastic term. So when you consider the stochastic term, when the distribution of the noise function becomes more spread, when you consider an alpha scale transformation, it turns out that the highest order statistic for the noise term is gonna get bigger and bigger. And the difference between these expected highest noise term is gonna get wider and wider. So for sufficiently high enough alpha, you actually will have this term dominate this term, and therefore the non-exclusive case in which agents can freely participate will be better. So the insight from here is that for contests that seek lower novelty solutions like top coder software bugs, then it may make sense to discourage participation. Whereas for the major innovation, like some contests of Innocentive, encouraging participation would be better. Second question, We are also interested in how does the profit, the organizer's profit, change with the number of contests. And we also ask a secondary question here, which is that how does optimal, so given that we find an optimal number of contests, we are also interested in how does the optimal number of contests change with output uncertainty, and we have results for both of them. The first result is that basically we show that the profit, the average profit is unimodal in number of contests. Basically, there is going to be some M star such that the profit is going to be increasing up to M star, and it's going to be decreasing after that M star. I'm going to give you an intuition for that as well. And the second one is, how does this M star change with basically alpha? So when we have more and more, distribution functions with higher variance, how does M star change? And it turns out that M star is increasing with alpha. So let me tell you the intuition for both of them. For the first result, so this also has something to do with the capacity too, all right? So think about the case in which we have, the number of contests is between 4 and 6, okay? Within this region, if you increase the number of contests, the capacity does not bind, okay? And there is a scope effect, which is that, remember, like our cost function is such that the effort that you put in contest one is actually helping you in contest two. So it actually is making you helping you, right? So it's decreasing your effort. So the scope effect means that if you have more contests, there is going to be more scope effect. It's going to be less, it's going to be more efficient for you to, put the effort. It's going to be less costly. Therefore, you will put more and more effort as a solver, and the organizer will benefit from this, okay? But between 6 and 8 here, basically after 6, what happens is the capacity starts binding, okay? So solvers cannot put more efforts anymore because they cannot, their capacity started binding. So there is a scarcity effect that kicks in. And there are two effects, scarcity effect and scope effect. And like till 8, basically, in this numerical calculation, the scope effect is still more, but eventually scarcity effect overweighs and then it starts going down. Okay, so this kind of shows why we will have a kind of like a unimodal way of, how does the organizer profit changing with respect to the number of contests. The second one actually has a similar intuition in the sense that, in this picture, we already kind of argued that when does the scarcity effect bind is the one that will determine when will we start going down, right? So if we have a higher alpha, okay, like a more novel contest, then there is going to be a smaller scarcity effect and smaller scope effect, okay? And, but the scarcity effect decreases with the solver's output uncertainty more than the scope effect. So this will mean that like this M star will start binding later, okay? For basically, like if you think about like a more noisy contest, you will not be putting a lot of efforts, and then therefore your capacity starts binding later as a function of the number of contests. Okay, there is a chat. Okay, let me read it. Maybe it's easier if you talk, Simona, but...
This can wait at the end. I didn't want to interrupt you necessarily. It's more for discussion,
so let's talk about this at the end because I think I have only 15 minutes. Okay, so but I'm done with the main results, but there are a lot of the other things that I want to tell you. So further results for the symmetric case, we have a lot of extensions. So one possibility is that rather than thinking about a total budget constraint, we can also consider the alternative in which there is no budget constraint, but there is a fixed cost of participating in each contest. Okay, so therefore, a symmetric equilibrium, okay, if an agent participates in M contests, capital M contests, maybe I should have called this like small m rather than thinking about this. Capital M is the total number of contests, but think about this as small m. If they participate in n number of contests, then this is gonna be like the in a symmetric equilibrium. This is gonna be my award, because in a symmetric equilibrium, I have n competitors. So the probability that I win the contest is 1 over n. And A is the award, A times n divided by n. And then there is this, like the cost term, okay, that we specified here. And then another fixed cost term, okay? So we look at this, and then we assume that each the parameters are such that each agent will be actually would like to participate in at least one contest. So the cost of fixed cost is not that high. And we had the following result. So again, this result actually interestingly depends on how concave the R function is. If it turns out that K is greater than 2, which means that it is more concave than exponential distribution, then it turns out that the solver's participation condition for holds for all m. Okay, so this means that actually they will be able to participate in all the contests, no matter how many contests that they have, given that they are they will be participating in one contest, they will be participating in all contests. But if the cost function R function is less concave than the exponential distribution, then we have the following result. When we consider a scale transformation alpha, with a parameter alpha greater than zero, then there exists a unique M upper bar such that the solver's participation condition is violated when M is greater than M upper bar. And also M upper bar is increasing in alpha. So this is a very similar result to our theorem two. Okay, for fixed costs of participation, we show that basically a very similar result holds for not too concave functions. So this is our result for an extension of fixed costs of participation. Another, further result is like when we are talking about the exclusive versus non-exclusive, we consider an extreme non-exclusive case, right? So we consider in which each solver needs to participate in one contest only. Here we consider an alternative, which is that let's consider the case in which we have capital N number of solvers, and one alternative is they freely participate in, there is one contest in which they all participate in, okay? And second one is that there are two contests and N1 number of them participate in contest one and capital N minus N1 number of them participate in the other contest. So basically this is about like splitting a contest into two. Okay, so, and for this one also, we have a similar result to our previous result, such that we show that basically this, the non-exclusive case, capital L upper bar, capital pi upper bar L, is going to be better than a single contest, which is like the non-exclusive case, if and only if the scale transformation value is smaller than some bound that we were able to explicitly pin down. Okay, so marginal insights, managerial insights. So this is a paper that we are aiming for. Management journals and managerial insights are important. So this is kind of like a summary of what I was saying. So let's just read this part. So with small uncertainty when seeking low novelty solutions, the managerial insight is that it is better to run multiple contests, of course, up to a certain number. You know, after some number, it's gonna start decreasing, and discourage agents from participating in multiple contests. So this is our basic suggestion. For large uncertainty, again, run multiple contests up to a certain number and encourage agents to participate in multiple contests. Okay. So let me talk about the new results that you haven't seen earlier. So now I'm going to go back to the beginning of the model in which I allow for the contests to be differentiated, the contests from different from each other. So we can allow for like tough like more noisy or less noisy contests. And we actually show that with asymmetric contests, our main results, theorem 1 and 2, continue to hold, but there are some interesting aspects on top of that. Okay, so what are these? The first result is that a kind of a generalization of our earlier result, which is that, now remember, we have capital J number of types of contests. And when I consider type L contests, okay, just a subset of contests, sub L. So we have, let's say that we have like top and medium and low type of contests, and I only consider a scale transformation among the top contests. And I do not change the scale transformation in anything else. It turns out that when I look at the comparison between exclusive and unexclusive case, like in which one extreme is like they freely participate in all contests and the other one is they need to participate in one contest only, for high enough alpha, the average profit will be higher. Again, so this is why this is a generalization of the early results, because in the early result, we have one type of contest and we actually change the alpha for all the contests. Now we have different kind of type of contests and we change the alpha for one type of contest, and still the average profit for high enough alpha will be higher with non-exclusive contests. Okay, but what is the interesting part? This does not necessarily mean that non-exclusive contests, non-exclusive case leads to larger profits for all types of organizers. So when we look at this in detail, when we look at not just the average payoff, average profit of the organizer, but the individual profits from different contests, we may have this kind of an example. So this is by an example. So here we have two types of contests, contest one and contest two, and we are only changing the doing a scale transformation to contest type one. Okay, and if we do that, if we change the alpha, what happens is when I look at the profit from type one contests, the non-exclusive case, non-exclusive case for high enough alpha, like greater than 0.9, starts being better. Okay, but when I look at type two contest profits, it doesn't actually go this way. It actually goes up and then goes down. And this also has something to do with the budget starts binding. So let's say that basically an effect on contest one has a different effect on contest two, and the contest type two contest actually may have lower profits, but we were able to show that basically when you look at the average profit, it's always increases for high enough alpha. Okay, so this is kind of like difference between the symmetric and asymmetric contest. With asymmetric contest, the average profit will increase with high alpha, but some individual ones may actually decrease. How about our second result? So in the second result, we are interested in like the optimal number of contests, right? And for this one, actually, our results is a little bit like less general in the sense that we were able to get result for not for the optimal awards, but for fixed awards. So when we fix an award, we can show that the organizer's profit for type L contests is unimodal in the number of contests in any type J. So it turns out that basically, like when I'm interested in maximizing my profit from type L contests, when I change the number of contests of type J, okay, and J and L can be equal to each other or different from each other, this even has a unimodal shape. So this is actually a strong result. So this is, I believe it's impressive. And similarly, from like similar to our like the earlier result related result, this optimal number is non-decreasing in alpha. So it's not increasing, but non-decreasing in alpha, in the sense that, like, if you have a for type L contests, if you have a more diverse distribution, then the optimal number of contests for type J is going to be increasing in this alpha. Okay. There is also a kind of like interesting aspect of this, which is that, so here our result is about, I only consider the profit for type L, right? Because I did not say anything about the average payoff. And actually, interestingly, the average profit can decrease. So think about the following. So let's say that we have two types of contests, contest one and contest two, and contest one is actually generating more revenue than contest two. And we increase the number of contest two. Okay, we now offer more and more contest two. So the average contest two profit will go up, and average contest one profit will go up, because our previous result tells us so, right? But since we have now more contest two, which is giving less profit, the average profit actually may go down, right? So, and we have an example for that. So this is some kind of like a curious observation that, like, the average profit result doesn't hold, but if I consider types of contests, our results continue to hold. So these are the new results from the last presentation. I have, I think, a couple minutes. So we also have a lot of extensions. So the new extensions that we had done in this version that I did not discuss last time is, the first one is, and we do these as extensions. So we need to have some simplifying assumptions. We need to consider some specific R rather than, you know, more general that we consider in the main body of the paper. But we were able to get the main result continue to hold with heterogeneous solvers. So in our, like, actually, like, it was misleading in our in the first slides that I actually claimed that our paper is homogeneous agents. Now in an extension, we actually allow for heterogeneous agents. So in this extension, we consider symmetric contests, but now we allow for the cost functions of the agents different from each other. Okay, so basically the cost functions are simplified, and they are multiplied by a scalar, and this scalar is common knowledge. So this is still a game with complete information, but the agents are differentiated. So for some agents, doing efforts are more costly. They are multiplied by a scalar, okay? And we actually show that our results, you know, we can solve similar results to our main results when we allow for heterogeneous solvers. Another criticism that we got from the referees were about the fact that our noise function is actually is just like an inadditive term, and it doesn't depend on the effort. And when we consider the case, a natural case actually, in which our the noise function also depends on my effort, in the sense that, let's say that I put a high effort, then the noise term is going to be more diverse. Okay, and for this one we can actually consider a multiplicative output function. So our original output function was what? It was R plus epsilon, right? Now we consider R of A hat IM and EIM. So they are multiplied. And this A hat is the one basically that kind of is the new noise term. And for this one, we actually had to do a little bit difficult things, like different things, because the standard scalar transformation didn't work, but we were able to get the result. And we put every extension of the revision to the online appendix, because we had too many extensions. Now we still keep them in the online appendix, but we consider the case in which we have the objective of the coordinator is not the sum of profits, is not the average profit, but the sum of profits. And we also have one case in which we consider decentralized contests, in the sense that there is no one organizer that organizes all the contests, but the contest organizers are choosing the awards independently. For this one, our results are like like for some cases, actually, we were not able to even solve for an equilibrium, but we find an upper bound for an equilibrium when we compare. So so this is kind of impartial in the sense that we do not characterize equilibrium sometimes. And another one is alternative model of economies of scope. So this extension looks at the case in which rather than linking the contests through the cost function, we assume that the cost functions are independent in the sense that my cost in contest M is just a function R of E, but my effort basically in contest M improves my quality in contest L. Okay, and we can actually kind of what we can do for this specific case is that we can transform this economies of scope, alternative economies of scope, to our model and show that our results also continue to hold here. Okay. Okay. Conclusion. I have. I think I'm exactly 1 hour. So when I'm late, I'm typically late. What I like to do in conclusion is to say that we do what we do. But since I have a few minutes, I think I'm going to just summarize what we have done. The main takeaway is that when the output uncertainty is large, non-exclusive case in which they are encouraged to participate in multiple contests is better idea than limiting the number of contests that they can participate in. And the organizers' profit increase up to a level, up to a number of contests, and then it decreases. And this optimal number of contests depends on solver's output uncertainty. For uncertainty, when uncertainty gets larger, then the optimal number of contests get larger. And as a technical contribution, we are able to solve a model of contests. I think what is very cool about our paper is that we have a cost function that exhibits diseconomies of scale, which is a convex cost function in within each contest, and economies of scope across the contest, which is my effort in contest L helps me in contest M. And we also consider like a capacity in terms of the efforts, and then we even like have an extension for cost for participation. So we were able to, I think, do in our revision a number of important extensions, such as allowing for heterogeneous contests and allowing for heterogeneous agents, and looking for the multiplicative output function rather than the additive output function. But there are some other things to be done. So basically our conclusion is that our paper brings theory closer to practice, and for future directions, we do not know anything about asymmetric equilibria. It could be interesting. Or I think maybe to make our model more close to the practice, what's happening is that it's like these contests are not basically running simultaneously deciding on this, but they are running sequentially. And of course, I think one will need to simplify our model. Our model may be too difficult, but it would be interesting to consider, for instance, the case in which, let's say that there will be two contests, one contest right now and one contest a month later. And I know that if I start working on this contest right now, I will not be able to finish contest one before contest two starts. So basically, when contest two starts, I will be either just working on this contest or working on multiple contests. So this dynamic aspect, the duration of contests, and under these assumptions, how should the organizers be spreading out, or how the deciding how many contests to offer, will be an interesting question to ask for future traction. So thank you. I can take your questions right now.
Right. Thanks, Lisa. I think Simona had questions.
Simona, do you want to me to read it, or do you want to?
Oh, it was more like a comment that came to mind, because you're looking at the decision of how much effort to put in,
yes,
in any given contest, right? But yeah, one could think of this as also choosing a probability of participating in one and the other with any given level of effort. So kind of...
So like you want to fix the effort levels, kind of like it's not the decision, but this is the decision is which contest to participate in. And well, in that model, it may make sense to consider like a mixed strategies.
Yeah, something like that. Because especially in the case where you look at symmetric equilibria anyway, and you look at homogeneous, then essentially, you know, it's either you participate when you do and you do the same effort as anyone else, but then maybe the decision would be probabilistically how much degree of participation you want to have, rather, perhaps.
And then one can think about, like, I don't know, like maybe, you know, half of the, you know, solvers participating in contest one and half of the solvers participating in contest two, something like that. Like either there will be some mixing overall or some kind of
So to leave that free to free to vary in equilibrium to see whether it would be always the case.
Yeah, that, I think that would be a completely different model, but I think it may make sense under some. I think there are like questions. There are like this like the you know, lifeboat problems or you know, Colonel Blotto problems.
It reminds me of something like that, right? Because you have to decide, you choose which, where you put your troops, and you might do so, like some flipping on the coin of some kind.
Yeah,
well, not 50-50, but you know, some probabilistic.
Depending on the depending on how much effort you put.
But yeah, just more common.
Mm. Okay, sure.
Thanks.
Of course.
Can I ask one question? So I think in your extension, you have the objective function looking at the sum of the profit.
Yes.
So I just wanted to know a bit more about that. But does it change your results qualitatively, or it doesn't change your results much?
It doesn't, like qualitatively doesn't change.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Now it's in the online appendix. I don't know, but yeah, I think like for at least for the, you know, top coder or Innocentive, you know, average profit is a natural assumption, but there would be cases in which the sum is more natural. But basically, like both theorem and theorem two holds. We have extensions of that.
Mm-hmm. I see.
Any other questions? Okay, thank you.
So, all right, thank you. Yeah, thank you so much, Isa.
Thank you.
My pleasure.
Yes, thanks. Thanks very much, Isa. Wonderful talk. So let's end the session now. Thanking Isa with a hand clap, a virtual hand clap. There you go.
Thank you.
And thank you. I hope to see you next week with Andreas Kleiner at the same time and same place.
Okay. We'll be here. All right.
Bye-bye,
Thank you, guys.
Thank you very much. Bye-bye.